know, something I've never really thought of. How can music bring history alive? Well, I mean, I think, like, with Dálava, Julie and I, what we're doing is she's taking these old songs and, you know, we don't... When we were in the Czech Republic last summer, we only heard one of the songs that are on that record. And so perhaps these are songs that aren't really sung very much. And so by singing them again, we're essentially bringing them alive and bringing awareness to them. And it's we're doing it in a completely different context and a completely different way musically, but it's making them alive again. So Zorn actually was the one, John Zorn was the one who originally recommended me to Lou. And I went in, the first thing he said to me was, "You're not gonna play jazz, are you? Because this is a rock band." So, which was great. But he also was a deeper listener of jazz and to Ornette Coleman and to Don Cherry than any other person I've ever met. So I smoked the audition, and then I think it was like a week later I did my first gig with him. It was Hal Wilner Freedom Riders. And I was playing with like James Carter and Kenny Wollison and all these guys from the Lounge Lizards were in the band, like all my idols. I was like, whoa, on stage with Lou in front of 5,000 people at Prospect Park. And the soundtracks were always hours. Usually most bands do a soundtrack and it's done, just quickly check everything. But he would work on stuff and he was like, you know, the saxophone doesn't sound right. It sounds too much like a saxophone. And we spent like 2 hours like with fuzz pedals, like trying to get a new sound with the sax. But, you know, I said this once in an article I wrote, like, he was like already established, he was wealthy, he was already in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, one of the most influential artists of all time, and he could have just been like, we'll just do the gig. But he was always exploring and curious, and he was like on the ground playing with the pedals like he was like a 15-year-old. So I think that's like a really big lesson I learned from Lou, is to always be curious and to just don't be lazy. I'm always interested in that, but I never want to, like with Dálava, like I don't want to ever make a traditional record. I would never want to study Indian music and put out an Indian record, because I always feel like when I hear stuff like that, it usually sounds to me like it's missing a little something. Like, I'm from New York in the US, I have a blues background. Like, I'm not gonna be able to do that in a really great way. But that doesn't mean I can't be into the music and learn from it, and, you know, but like, if Dálava had been like taking these folk songs and trying to make them traditional, it would have sucked. It wouldn't have been good. It wouldn't have been, but it ended up being like a really beautiful work because we did something that was really our own. Well, see, I'm also an educator, so I would have to think about what song would teach kids something. Oh, Ati Moya from Dálava. It's like a 6-8 kind of R&B thing, so it would teach the kids how to have a good feel on 6-8 swing. And then the it goes up to the major thing, which is cool, so you learn like about starting in minor and then going up to major. It's like basically based on like a classic like Otis Redding kind of R&B tune, even though it's a Czech folk song. So yeah, I think that would probably teach people some good things, hopefully.